It is now my honor to ask Dr. Pim Valkenberg. He is the Ordinary Professor of Religion and Culture at the Catholic University of America. He's a very good friend. Please welcome him.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really honored to be here. Maybe some of you have noticed that I arrived only 10 minutes ago because of the traffic in the center of the D.C. area. And since I'm newly appointed to a university in the northeastern part of the D.C. area, you can imagine that I had some trouble getting here in time. I'm sorry for that. Tonight, we are celebrating a dinner of friendship, remembering the importance of living together as an act of intercultural and interreligious dialogue. And since I am appointed to teach about interreligious dialogue here in the DC area, I thought the best for me would be to tell you a little bit about how I understand this dialogue as a contribution to our living together here. This morning I taught a class about the documents of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue, which is one of the organizations in the Roman Catholic Church that deals with relations with other religions. And that council has published a number of documents in which it discusses the relation between, and now I'm saying something that probably some of you will find very strange, mission and dialogue. On the one hand, that seems to be very strange and even a problem. If it is true that dialogue means, first of all, to be open to another person, to listen, and mission, we usually think about as, first of all, talking to someone. And of course, you know that Christians and some Muslims really can talk a lot to others about that. So these two seem to be contrary to one another. The idea of mission seems to be contrary to the spirit of dialogue. Yet I think in the two traditions that I know a little bit more of, Christianity and Islam, they have everything related to one another. Of course, mission or proclamation is, or evangelization are some of the words that are nowadays used in Christianity. Dawah is the term for Muslims. And I've been trying to tell a little bit about that to my students. And what I found interesting in thinking about that, and that's why I want to bring this up this afternoon or this evening even. I'm still behind in my clock. Sorry. That's why I want to bring a little bit about that here also, is that the documents give a kind of an idea of what mission should be. Of course, we immediately associate mission or dawah, if we talk about the Muslim side of that, of proclaiming the gospel, proclaiming the word of God in the Quran, to other people and telling them the truth about it. Now, the interesting thing is that these documents have a much broader take on the idea of dialogue. They say, well, first of all, it is to be a presence. So it is to be being with people, communicating with people. And one of the interesting things is I've done some study of medieval text. In Latin, the word communicare, from which our word communication comes, means much more than just to communicate. I mean, if I'm texting while sitting in the car with Jenna saying, yeah, I will be coming in half an hour, I'm of course communicating. But this Latin word communicate, communicare, meant in fact to be friends with one another and to deal with one another and to live with one another in a friendly way. And in an open way. And therefore, you had all kinds of questions in theological works in the Middle Ages. Can you communicate with Muslims? Can you communicate with unbelievers? I mean, that's, of course, the terminology that they use. So I think every form of communication begins with a kind of a friendship. That's, of course, not always true. I mean, I had to send an email to a student who wanted to change the date of her exam next week because she apparently her brother is graduating, and she only thought about telling me that yesterday. Well, that's, of course, not a form of communication that is based on love and friendship. But I think it's something to bear in mind maybe if we communicate in all the communication that we do, that this basic idea of living together and this basic idea of listening to one another and being present with one another is at the background of that. So I think the basis of what I try to tell some of my students about as intercultural and interreligious dialogue is to be present with people, to go out of your own comfort zone, as we say nowadays, or to go out of your own bubble and to visit people of other religions, for instance. So that's something that I tell my students to do. And well, some of them will come to the Turkish American Friendship Association and to the Rumi Forum, I guess. But it is also what we can learn from many other cultures who have had a much longer history of living together than we have here in the United States or in Europe, where I come from. Of course, the Ottoman Empire, in the long history that it had, is a good example of that. The Lebanon is a good example of that. Al-Andalus, southern Spain in the Middle Ages, is a good example of that. And I noticed that in the Lebanon, they talk, well, maybe not so much anymore, but they used to talk a lot about convivance, living together, convivencia in Spain in the Middle Ages. Now, one of the things that fascinate me in that is that you can see that there are times that we can really learn how to live together, but there are also times that it gets really difficult. My own country, where I come from, the Netherlands, might be not so good, I think, example of that. Of course, we had the name of being very welcoming, mainly to Jews, in the 17th century, in our so-called Golden Age. But of course, you know about Theo van Gogh, Geert Wilders, and some of others who are not really representative of this welcoming aspect. And I also noticed, if you look at history, the Lebanon, Sri Lanka, the Balkans, once again, there are many, and of course Spain in the Middle Ages, sometimes it went really good, but sometimes it really went wrong. So apparently we don't have any guarantee in history that just to live together and to be friendly to one another will really bring us any further. At the same time, I think it's the only thing we can do. So I have learned in a number of experiences and in a number of occasions that just to learn to live with one another and to serve one another and to be friends with one another just gives you this basis of knowing how to find one another when things go wrong. And I think that's what happened with many of us after 9/11. That's what's happening in the Netherlands now, that people trying to find one another once again and say, okay, this is not the way it's meant to be. So how can we do it differently? And I think that's the big importance of friendship as a kind of a human way to try to keep one another's company and to keep communicating with one another in the sense that I just described. And I think that is what we can learn from one another, from other cultures, and we in the West can learn really a lot from Turkish people, but also from people in Asia, from people in Africa, about how to do that. So I think that is the importance of living together, of having intercultural friendships, and also of celebrating our friendship, because there might come times when we really need one another. And let me close, just like my two predecessors did, with recalling a few words of Fethullah Gülen, the president of Rumi Forum, who is, I think, one of the greatest teachers of intercultural friendships. I think one of the things that I learned from him is friendships are based on openness and trust. A trust that is, for him, ultimately a religious trust. You can trust other human beings because you know that their ultimate source is their creator, who has built in us a core of faithfulness, or fitra. I think this is one thing that Christians and Muslims have in common, and that we can still learn from one another and maybe also share with those of us who don't call them faithful people. We can trust one another because we know that there is some other reality that we really can have faith in. Thank you, Matt.